Cynthia and I found out late yesterday evening that a very good friend of ours passed away on Monday. He had been battling prostate cancer for the last several years, and the irony of hearing that he had passed away on Monday is that about the time he passed away, I was sitting in a synagogue at a memorial service for the father of a woman who attended the Olive Tree congregation several years ago. And so both of those events bring the idea of death and the afterlife into graphic relief in my own thinking. And what was interesting, though, is the difference between the memorial services. The one at the synagogue was really, it was a beautiful service in many, many ways, a real testament to the life and legacy of the man who had passed away, his family, his children especially, a couple of his children, his grandson also got up and spoke. A co-worker got up and spoke, and they shared their deep appreciation for this man and for the positive impact that he had had on their lives. But what was interesting is that there was no direct talk about life after death in that service. The idea of living on eternally following death was only mentioned in passing, because some of the liturgy happened to include that. It just was not a focus of the service. And I would imagine that at my friend's memorial service, which is coming up next week on Friday, it will be very different in that regard. I'm sure many people will get up and share the profound impact that this man had on their lives, especially in the last few years as we watched him struggle with cancer, and we watched him process all of that in his relationship with the Lord, and to see the fruit that was born not only in his own life, but in his family and in the lives of the people around him. But at that service, I am expecting that eternal life and the topic of what happens after death and where this brother in the Lord is, and the fact that he's having a really good day, even though we're miserable and suffering in light of his loss. I'm sure that's going to be the focus. That's going to be the focus. And so what's interesting is today's text raises the question everyone is asking at a funeral service or at any time that we are faced with the certainty of our own death, our physical death. And it's the question that is contained in our text: what shall I do to inherit eternal life? Now, as we go through Mark 10, chapter 10, verses 17 to 31, we'll see what Yeshua's answer is to this question of questions. What shall I do to inherit eternal life? And so, as we look through our text this morning, the answer comes back to us. To inherit eternal life, we must forsake and find. And that's exactly the pattern that we see in our text this morning. So the first thing that we want to look at as we're thinking about this question of eternal life and life after death and what happens to us and whether or not we have something to look forward to in our death and in the deaths of those we love, or whether we are going to live in dread and fear and anxiety about not knowing what is going to happen to us. And so the first thing that I want us to look at comes from chapter 10, the biggest chunk of our passage this morning, chapter 10, verses 17 to 27, because Yeshua calls us to forsake what fails. In other words, when we think about inheriting, how do we receive, how do we gain eternal life? The first thing Yeshua wants to make sure we understand is that we must forsake that which is going to fail us in our pursuit of eternal life. And that's the first thing that we see in our text, as Mark tells us this rather amazing story, this really touching story of Yeshua's engagement with a man who was wealthy. And from the other Gospels, we know that he was not only rich, but we know that he was young, and we know that he was a ruler as well. He was somebody in authority, somebody respected in the community. So look with me at chapter 10, verse 17. It says, as Yeshua was setting out on a journey or on his way, on his path, a man ran up to him and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life?" And so Yeshua is on his way up to Jerusalem as this is taking place. Remember, he had been across the Jordan just recently in the last section, and he's now making his way back towards Jerusalem. Next week, we're going to see him in the vicinity of Jericho. So he's on his way to Jerusalem for the final weeks of his life. And this man, Mark tells us, look what it says. He ran up to him and he knelt before him. And so here's a guy who is motivated. He sees his opportunity and he has a question that he wants to ask Yeshua. And it says he knelt before him. And then he addresses him as good teacher, good teacher. And so this man has an obvious respect for Yeshua. And unlike the others who came to him asking questions, of whom we had read previously, this was not a trap. This was not an insincere question that was posed in order to trip him up, to get him to say something that would get him into trouble with the Romans or with the religious authority. This was a sincere question. Maybe this man had just come back from a funeral. Maybe something had happened in his life that really brought upon him this realization that when he died, he wanted to know that he was going to have the honor and the privilege of entering into eternal life, of inheriting eternal life. And so Yeshua takes this question at face value, and he understands, of course, that he's not trying to trap him. This young man is not trying to trap Yeshua, but that this is indeed a sincere question, and Yeshua answers it as a sincere question. And if we look at verses 18 and following, at Yeshua's answer, we see that he exposes this young man's presuppositions about how to gain eternal life. How to gain eternal life. And he says this. He says, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone." And apparently, if you study through the rabbinic literature of the day, et cetera, that the rabbis actually resisted being called good in this way. And so he was really trying to elevate his view of Messiah. He was really trying to express the high view that he had of Messiah, and yet Yeshua challenges him on it, and he says, "Why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone." And so he's basically saying to the guy, he's not denying that he's good, and Yeshua is not denying that he's God. That's not the point of his question here. The point of his question is he's challenging this man's value system. And he's saying, do you really appreciate and understand what you're talking about when you call me good? And the authority that I have and the nature of the teaching that I deliver. And so he challenges his standard. And then he goes on and he reveals the man's presuppositions. And he says to him simply, he doesn't say this is what you need to do. He simply says this. "You know the commandments: do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal, which do not bear false witness, do not defraud, honor your father and mother." And so for those of you who are familiar with the 10 words, which half of the 10 words is this, does he quote from? The second half, right? The second half, what we would call the horizontal half of the 10 commandments, the commandments that pertain to our relationships one to the other. And of course, he lists the commandments, commandments 6, 7, 8, 9. There's some debate about whether by "do not defraud," he has a reference there to commandment number 10 about not coveting, etc. And then he goes on and he goes back, he doubles back to commandment number 5, which is the hinge commandment between the vertical commandments and the horizontal commandments. And he says, you know the commandments. This is what the scriptures say. And so the man says to him in verse 20, "Teacher, I have kept all these things from my youth up." When he says from my youth up, he's talking about probably from the age of 13, from the time when his vow was considered valid in the community as a legal vow. He's saying that to the best of my ability, I have done these things. And so he's confident because that's his immediate response. And yet, he's the guy who ran up to Yeshua and said, "How shall I inherit eternal life?" And so there's doubt in his mind about whether or not his behavior is going to be sufficient. And so he exposes very clearly, Yeshua exposes very clearly that this guy is focused on his receiving or inheriting eternal life based on his behavior. And then I love these verses. Look at verse 21. I love what Mark says here. "Looking at him, Yeshua loved him." In NASB, it says, "Looking at him, Yeshua felt a love for him." But literally, it simply says, "Looking at him, Yeshua loved him and said to him." And so why does Mark give us this insight? Why does he report, "And Yeshua loved him"? It's the only place in the Gospel of Mark where it says, "And Yeshua loved somebody." And I think it's there because he wants us to understand what motivates Yeshua's response to this young man. He wants us to understand that it is his love, his compassion, his commitment to him that motivates this rather alarming response. Because he goes on and he says, "Looking at him, Yeshua loved him and said to him, 'One thing you lack. Go and sell all your possessions and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me.'" He says, give to the poor, sell everything you've got, give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven, and come and follow me. And so because of the length of the text, we don't have time to unpack everything. There's a whole sermon right in there. But the idea here is that he says, it's interesting, he says, there's one thing you lack. And then he goes on and he lists several things, right? But what is the one thing that he lacks? And we begin to understand what that is as we see his response to Yeshua's command. He says, but at these words, NASB says, he was saddened. Another way to translate this was his face fell, or even better would be, at these words, he was gloomy. So he came, he ran, he bowed down. "Master, teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Yeshua says, "You know what the word says?" And he says, "I've kept all those things." And he says, "Great, you're missing only one thing." And the guy's going, "Okay, lay it on me." And he says, "Sell everything you have, give it away to the poor, make yourself dependent, and come and follow me." And he goes away sad, and Mark tells us why. For he was one who owned much property. Much property. And so here is a man who, in the eyes of the community, had it made. He was wealthy. He was young. He was well respected. He was a leader in the community. And yet Yeshua says to him, there's one thing that you are missing. And so I want you to stop and think about it for a minute. He listed which half of the tablet? The second half, the horizontal half. What is the one thing pointing to? The first half. You shall love the Lord your God and have no other gods before him. And Yeshua knew this young man's heart. And he knew that even though he longed for the hope of entering God's kingdom and experiencing eternal life, that his money was that in which he trusted more than God. And he said to him, you have a whole system of beliefs that will not get you what you want because your heart is not right before the only one who can give you what you want. And he challenges him, and this young man goes away. And so this is an illustration. Mark gives us an illustration. He doesn't do any teaching to this young man. He just has him leave, and we don't know what happens to him. We don't know if he ever comes to do what Yeshua commanded him to do. Now, in reading this, I want to say something very clearly. This command that Yeshua gave to him was specifically for him because Yeshua knew his need. And he knew that it was money that was getting in this man's way. And so when we read this, I don't want you to think that you have to give up all of your money. And that'll become clear, I think clearer, as we look at the rest of the text. But certainly the principle that comes out here is that whatever it is in which you are trusting for your life on earth that isn't God is keeping you from the one person who can give you what you need most, that is eternal life. And so it goes on, our text goes on, and now Mark records for us the application, the teaching that Yeshua is going to give based on this interaction with this young man. And it says in verse 23, and Yeshua, looking around, said to his disciples, how hard it will be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. And so when I didn't point this out earlier, when he said, how shall I inherit eternal life? In the young man's thinking, that is synonymous with entering the kingdom of God. That is synonymous with being able to enter into the kingdom that God establishes on this earth, through which he will reign over all other kingdoms on the earth. Whether he understood it as a messianic kingdom is not clear from this text, but can be assumed, I believe. And he is thinking in terms of entering God's kingdom, not thinking about some ethereal kind of up in the clouds dwelling. He's thinking about living in the presence of God himself as he rules and reigns over Israel. And Yeshua goes on and he says, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. They were more astonished and said to him, then who can be saved? I love this. He says, how hard it will be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. The disciples were amazed at his words. Why were they amazed at his words? Well, in their thinking, it was the wealthy that God had blessed. Because if you read through Deuteronomy, you read through the Torah, it says, if you obey me, that's the key to life. If you obey me, I will prosper you. And so the implications of that was that those who were living their lives in accordance to Torah and who had prospered materially were those who were blessed spiritually. And they were shoo-ins for the kingdom. They were the ones with the seats of honor at the synagogue. They were the ones who were called up to read from the scrolls. They were ones who were given honor in their community, in their community. And yet, Yeshua says, how hard it will be for those who are wealthy to enter the kingdom of God. And they're going, what? What? I mean, if you were Catholic, forgive me if this offends you, I hope it doesn't, but I think it's a good illustration. If Yeshua said how difficult it is for the Pope and the Cardinals to enter heaven. What? 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 And then he reinforces it after he sees the shock on their faces, right? They were amazed. But Jesus answered again and said to them, so they must have said, what? Are you nuts? Are you crazy? That doesn't make any sense. How can that be? And so in response to their amazement, he says to them, children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter the kingdom of God. So what do you think he meant when he said that? Now, I remember reading somewhere about there's a gate, a small gate, a low gate, and the camel, it's called the eye of the needle, and if a camel has to get down on its knees to go through that gate, and it's a picture of us needing to humble ourselves on our knees before God in order to enter the kingdom of God. No, it's not what he meant. It's not what he meant. He held up a needle, and he pointed to a camel, and he said, rich people in general, have as much chance of entering heaven as that camel can fit through this needle. And how do we know that's what he meant? Because the text says they were even more astonished. And they said to him, then who can be saved? Jesus said, it's impossible. And so they wisely respond with, then who? Who can be saved? And then it says, looking at them, Jesus said, with people it is impossible, but not with God, for all things are possible with God. And so what's Yeshua say? What's he saying to them? He's saying, look, we just saw this young guy. He had everything going for him, but his hope was in what he could do to inherit eternal life. And I'm telling you, that guy who you think has the best chance of getting into the kingdom of heaven has no chance of getting into the kingdom of heaven. And they figured out, if that's the case, then no one has a chance of getting into the kingdom of heaven. And Yeshua said, bingo. Bingo. Whatever it is that you are relying on will fail if it is not what God himself provides. That's basically what he's saying. That's what he's saying. And so the idea here is that we need to forsake that which is going to fail. That which is going to fail. And we've talked about this a lot in our community, and we talk about it a lot in our community, and it comes up over and over and over again because the text brings it up over and over and over again. But we are wired this way, are we not? To merit, to earn God's love and God's respect for us. And we think ourselves wise and noble and good, and we want to believe that that's going to be enough in the sight of God for him to receive us and accept us and to give us eternal life, to welcome us into his kingdom. And he says, no, you have to forsake that. And I just want us to stop and take just a few seconds to think about it. For this young man, Yeshua, because he loved him, said, no, you got to give up your love of money and put your trust in God instead. Yeshua said, he says, you cannot love God and wealth. You cannot serve two masters, for you will love the one and despise the other. You're going to serve one and not the other. And this young man, even though he did not realize it, it was his money in which he had put his trust. And so whatever it is in which you are trusting, Yeshua says, put it off, because it's going to fail you ultimately when it comes to receiving, inheriting the gift of eternal life. And he calls us to forsake it. But then the text goes on, and he doesn't leave us there. He gives us a hint that there's hope. He says, with people it's impossible. In other words, there's nothing you can do that is going to enable you to inherit eternal life. But with God, all things are possible. And so he's trying to get them to start thinking about God has got to do something. And what is God going to do? And in the next verse, the next section that we're going to be looking at next week, we'll see Yeshua once again describing his death, burial, and resurrection. And he's pointing ahead and he's saying, this is what God is going to provide. This is what's going to make the impossible possible according to God's economy. And so it goes on in verse 28. And so Yeshua calls us to forsake that which fails or what fails, but he also calls us to find what's going to last. Because look at Peter. I love Peter. He's always out there. He's just speaking his heart. He says, Peter then began to say to him, behold, we've left everything and followed you. And what do you think he meant by that? Do you think he was going, we're in? I don't think that's what he meant, because Yeshua's response doesn't indicate that. I think he was saying, what? Are we in? Am I in? Right? Because he just said, no one. And so now Peter wants to know, am I in? And then Yeshua responds, and he confirms and he affirms this wonderful reality. He says in verse 29, truly I say to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or farm for my sake and for the good news sake. Isn't that interesting? For my sake and the good news sake. Not just me as your good teacher. Not just me as the one who is teaching these mind-blowing lessons. Not just me who is raising the dead and healing the sick and casting out demons. But me, the one who is at the heart of the good news, for the good news sake. That's what he says. For the good news sake. And they don't even understand what the good news is at this point, but he does. And he says, whatever you give up in order to find that which lasts, you can have confidence. You can have confidence. He's saying, yes, in fact, you will receive abundant life in this life and in the life to come, which, of course, is exactly what Jesus says in the Gospel of John. But he says it differently here in Mark. I say truly to you, there is no one who has left house or brothers, father, sister, mother, father, children or farm for my sake and for the gospel's sake, but that he will receive 100 times as much. And so, what is he looking for, a literal 100 times? No. This is just saying, this is supernatural. This is a supernatural explosion of the riches in your life. And he's not necessarily talking about the same kind of riches expressed in the same way that the rich young man had who was struggling. But the wealth that we have in Messiah and the wealth that we have in a family that goes beyond the people to whom we are physically related, to a family that is comprised of all people, Jewish and Gentile, who are born again into Messiah through faith in him. And we have 100-fold now in the present age houses and brothers and sisters and mothers and children and farms. We have all of that in abundance supernaturally. So what's Yeshua saying? He's saying, look, yes, following me is the right thing to do. But you are not giving anything up by following me. If you think what you are giving up is of value, look at what you're going to get in exchange. Whatever you think you have to give up to follow me is just a pittance compared to what you're going to receive. Of course, this is not a health and wealth gospel, and Jesus wants us to understand that, because he also says, with persecutions. With persecutions, and he already had spoken about persecutions, and the persecutions of which he speaks are not just the trials of life, which everybody is going to suffer, but the trials of life that we suffer specifically because we are taking a stand for Messiah, and we are telling other people the good news, and we are telling people that there is no other way to eternal life, there is no other way to a relationship with God apart from faith in Messiah Jesus. And because of that message, and because of its uniqueness, we will suffer persecution for his sake. And so it is not a health and wealth gospel, but it is a gospel that is chock full of riches. And he says, not only will you experience abundance in this life, but you will what does it say? The end of verse 30. And the age to come, eternal life. The age to come, eternal life. So you get abundance now, and you get God's kingdom in the future. You get abundance beyond our understanding. And so Yeshua says, yes, forsake what fails, but find what lasts forever. In finding me, Yeshua says, you find eternal life. In finding me, you find abundance in your life. In finding me, you find that which you cannot find on your own. On your own. And I want you to stop and think for a minute. Perhaps this morning, there's something you know that is keeping you from putting your trust in Messiah. There's something that you're holding on to. And perhaps it's real. And perhaps, you know, for this rich young ruler, it was real. It was a significant thing in his life. And I was thinking about the application of this verse, and I thought about a young man that I met recently. I've mentioned before from the pulpit. We'll call him Jesse, who is from a very strict Hasidic sect, of Lithuanian Jewish sect. Grew up going to the cheder, to the school, and then he went on to study Talmud as a teenager, as a young adult. Began to ask questions of the rabbis, was asked to leave the seminary in which he was studying, and met some believers in Messiah who began to share the good news with him. And it began to make sense. And he began to see what the scriptures taught about Messiah and what they teach about Yeshua and his fulfillment of what the scriptures say Messiah would do. But I want you to stop and think. His whole life was based on his identity as an observant Jew. And not only was his relationship with God based on the religious structure in which he was raised, but that his entire life was rooted in that community. And that to come to faith in Messiah Jesus would mean putting all of that at risk. Apostle Paul said he was the Hebrew of Hebrews. No one could out-observe him in his commitment to his orthodox identity. And yet he got to a point where he said, I now see that all of that, as precious and as valuable as it is to me, will fail me when it comes to being in a right relationship with God. And Jesse came to that point. And he literally had to say, God, I want you and what you offered to me, and I am willing to give up not only my cherished religious convictions, but my family and my job, my hope of income, the community that has taken me in and made me a part of it, that has guided me and spoken to every area of my life. And I am willing, Lord, to turn from all of that because it will fail me and put my trust in you. So this morning, whatever it is, for me, when I was coming to faith, it was not my Orthodox Jewish identity because I wasn't raised Orthodox. But for me, it was my Jewish identity. It was being a Jew the way I was raised to be Jewish, and that was definitely not a believer in Jesus. And that for me, in my thinking, in my worldview, that's what I was trusting in. I was trusting in that identity. I was trusting that because I was a physical heir of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and if I clung to that identity to the exclusion of all else, that would be sufficient. And God in his mercy looked at me at some point and loved me. And he said, yes, even that. Even that, even your parents, even your brothers, even your aunts and uncles and cousins, and the community that you knew, the community in which you grew up, your family and friends, even that, and come to me. And because he loved me, and because he gave me grace to forsake that which was not going to work, that which would fail, ultimately, I found that which would work. I found that which gives life. Jesse found that which would give life. Paul, the apostle, found that which gives life. We found Yeshua, the Messiah. And we came to him and we put our trust in him. And I can't tell you how much my joy and my pride in the best possible way and my commitment to my Jewish identity has exploded 100-fold because of what Messiah has done for me and because of who I am in Messiah. And this morning I would say to you, whatever it is you're holding on to, is it a relationship? Is it money? Whatever it is, is it your identity? Maybe it's not a religious identity. Maybe it's a gender identity. Whatever it is that's holding you back, Yeshua says, let that go and come to me. Forsake that and find me, and I will give you life that you will not believe, both now and into eternity. So we come and we face death. All of us will. All of us will. That question comes up, how will we inherit eternal life? And Yeshua comes back with the answer. Forsake that which is going to for sure fail and find that which will work every time, now and for all eternity in coming to him. We have a great message to bring a world that is dying. May God embolden our hearts to proclaim it with love. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for your word, and we thank you for giving us this challenge from our Messiah, Lord, this very forthright, direct repudiation of all that we might trust in apart from him for eternal life. Lord, give us grace. I pray for those who are in our midst this morning that today would be the day that they will yield to you, that they will lay that down. They will not be like the rich man who walked away with a gloomy face and his heart grieving, Lord, because they are unwilling to turn away from whatever it is they're trusting in, Lord. But I pray that today would be the day they turn away from that and they turn to you, Lord, and they bring that burden to you, and they bring their need to you, and they find the sufficiency of Messiah in his death, burial, and resurrection for them. Lord, we thank you that you receive all those who come to you in faith. So we thank you that we can pray these things, knowing it's your will. So we pray them confidently in Yeshua's name. Amen.